Hey guys, it's Jeff Lafferty. It's Artcast 557. Today I'm doing an interview with the creators of a comic book called Movie Men. It's on Indiegogo right now. The writer is Jeremy Lott and the artist is Doug Curtis. And it's a great little interview. I had some technical difficulties during the interview though. I wanted to have them both on the show at the same time. When I brought them on in Google Hangouts for whatever reason, I could hear them, but they couldn't hear each other. So there was no way to really record a show with all three of us. So I do Doug's interview first. I talk about the art, and then I talk to Jeremy second, and we talk about the writing. And he's the creator of the entire project, so he kind of fills in all the just the creation stuff and how they're going to produce it and what they're going to do once it's funded and all that kind of thing. I also recorded this interview it's probably been like 4 weeks. I've had this Indiegogo going for a while. And back then it was like at 50 days. Now it's down to like 16 days or something. So hopefully it won't be too late. I recorded it, right before I got sick. And then I got sick and then I just didn't, edit it right away. And it sat on my computer and It just kind of fell into the, I'll get to that sometime pile. And I just didn't get to it, but now I have. I'll be painting a Creature from the Black Lagoon piece while I'm talking to these guys, so hopefully you guys enjoy the show. Welcome to the show, Doug Curtis. How are you?
Thanks, Doug. I'm doing great, thank you.
All right, great. So you're the artist on the comic Monster Men, or no, not Monster Men, Movie Men.
Yep. Well, there are monsters in it, so.
Right, I guess I got that on the brain, monsters or something. But yeah, so what's your story? I don't know you at all, really, but I appreciate you coming on. So are you have you drawn comics like before? Is this your first one? You've been working on it a long time. Like, what's the deal?
Well, I really started out with a web comic actually back in 1996. So it's probably one of the older web comics online. It's called The Flying Ferret. That's my crazy dog. It was called The Flying Ferret, yeah. So did that, and then I worked for Kenzer and Company for a while. Did some months. They did a Hacklopedia, their Hackmaster, RPG game system. So did a lot of monster illustrations for them and game illustrations for them. So that was. And then I had a little breakthrough comic. It was a 3-issue comic called Space Hack. That I kind of did a 1-page thing in their Knights of the Dinner Table fanzine or magazine there. Oh. And so I had that was probably my real big breakthrough and never really got back to it. So
how long ago did you start the web comic then?
1996. It's as old as my oldest daughter.
Wow. Yeah. It was like one of the original ones probably.
Probably. Yeah. Yep. And it was pretty rough way back then. So
yeah. Do you still do it or do you?
Oh yeah.
Retire. Oh really?
Still going. Yeah, wow. Updates are not real consistent because real life and all that. Yeah. But I keep it going. It's I'm starting to hit milestones with the comic that I've been wanting to do 15 years ago. So I'm starting to hit milestones, and it's like feels like I'm getting to the end of all the ideas that I had.
Yeah.
So, but it's been a kind of a labor of love. It's also been a pain in the butt because it's like I'm not getting anything out of this. It's just totally for free and.
Yeah.
So my wife looks at me and says, "Why are you doing this? You're not making any money off from this." So it's just, it's a labor of love. It's a parody comic and kind of parody old superheroes and stuff that I loved over the years.
Well, that's neat. Yeah, that's really cool that you like kept with it like for so long. I mean, I don't know. I've started and stopped a few web comics, and I know how tough it is to. Just keep them going and stay interested and all that kind of stuff. So that's really amazing. Is that like 24 years or something? That's a long time.
Yeah. I just started because my wife, we had the first child and I had nothing better to do. And she's taking care of my first daughter. And so it's like, well, I guess I'll do this. And just starting to get into the internet and stuff. And,
That's cool. So anyway, like I was saying, you're doing the comic Movie Men with Jeremy Lott, and you're doing like all the art yourself. You got like an inker or a team going on this, or is it just all you? Or
all me? Yeah. I do it all digital. So I really embrace that. you think I'm an older guy like me would be the more the old fashioned way, but I really embrace the digital side of it. So
that's neat. What kind of got you going towards digital? Because I imagine at one time you were probably, all traditional. And how come you got the interest in the digital and that kind of took over?
I kind of wanted shortcuts because I was doing I'm still doing that too. I got this little comic that I do for a newsletter, and they started wanting files digitally instead of prints. Said, okay, I'll jump on computer and start doing that. And so I bought my first Wacom, graphic tablet and stuff and computer, and scanned it in. And pretty soon I wanted to get rid of that middle ground, of scanning it in. I said, I would just really love to directly do it on the computer. So ever since then, I've been trying to move towards that, So I struggled with the Wacom tablet for the longest time. And finally, a friend of mine that I used to draw characters out of Valley Fair here in Minnesota, and Tom Nguyen, an inker for DC Comics, he later became, and he said, you got to buy a Surface Pro. So I said, I tried his and loved it, and I said, okay, I'm doing the Surface Pro. So I finally knuckled under and bought one, saved up and bought one. So I absolutely love it. It's just probably my favorite thing in the world right now.
Really?
So, so yeah.
That's cool. Do you work in like a program?
Clip Studio Pro.
Okay.
Yeah. I used Photoshop previously, and I just could never get it to do what I wanted to do.
Yeah.
And once I discovered Clip Studio Pro, my gosh, it like changed my world. I just absolutely loved it.
Yeah. I've heard a lot of people say like really good things about it and stuff. If I did digital stuff, I'd probably give it a shot, but
Right.
Can't learn that much new stuff at this point, I think. So, how did you and Jeremy hook up to do the comic? I mean, how'd you guys meet and stuff?
We were kind of on the same forums on Facebook, and I actually knew who Jeremy was before. Uh-huh. I used to be on this kind of this political forum, and I didn't realize I was reading articles written by him. And then later when I bumped into him on Facebook, I was like, I know you, it's like, I didn't realize, you'd be into comics and stuff. So that was kind of neat to kind of that little, connection, just like just meet a little celebrity, So, because I've read so many of his articles, I'm like, I agree with that, or that's interesting, So, then he started talking about wanting to do comics. He was pitching around ideas and kind of, and I'm a little blurry on this. Can't remember if I told him about my site or if he saw it or what, but then I kind of said, did you draw a movie, man? And I said, yeah. So I sent him, some pencils and stuff and kind of blossomed from there.
Yeah. What kind of, how do you guys do the, the scripts and stuff? I mean, does he give you like full scripts and.
Yeah, he gives me full scripts. Yep. So just kind of he already had the panels all figured out and everything, which is nice. I like it when they're, I'm this kind of a tough for me because I do everything myself before. So kind of collaborating with somebody else is different. I mean, I liked it, enjoyed it. It's kind of nice to bring somebody else's vision to life, if so to speak,
Yeah. Yeah. That's neat. I mean, It's a different thing, like drawing for somebody else than working on your own stuff. I mean, how's that can kind of compare you to working on your own stuff compared to,
In a way it's freeing because when I have to write and draw my own stuff, I'm sitting there pulling my hair out sometimes like, how am I going to do this? I got this idea but he's already got the idea. So I'm past that point of having an idea and, realizing it and it just makes it a little easier for me. I kind of enjoy it. I don't mind collaborating. So, and he's so easy to work with too, cause I've made a couple suggestions and he'll take them, it's like, he won't fight me on them, cause I've heard some horror stories about some collaborations where, you fight with the writer, but no, Jeremy's been great to work with and stuff and try to give him what he wants.
Yeah. Yeah. That's cool. It's nice when, the person you're working with's easy to get along with and stuff. So you guys are doing the Indiegogo as far as like the printing and that kind of thing. Like what are your guys' plans to how, like where are you going to print the books and, how far along are you? Are the books done yet or are they, are you in the process or?
I think Jeremy has those answers. I don't have.
Oh, really? Okay. Yeah. He's got all that kind of stuff out.
Yeah, he's got that information. Yeah. So I know he's looking into different printers. Last I knew, but yeah, I don't know on the my end yet. But yeah. And I know right now we're just into the promotion part, and I wish I was a little stronger with the promotion. I can't even promote my own stuff. So it's like, I hope I'm being helpful to him, you know, like, you know, retweet links and stuff and retweet or, you know, show stuff on Facebook, you know, just repost it, you know. I hope I'm doing enough, you know. I wish I could do a little more because I'm kind of busy too, because there's other things I'm doing, like I'm into plays right now and writing. And so it's like a lot irons in the fire right now.
Like plays, like as an actor or?
Yeah, I act and write, and yeah, my wife and I are acting in a play together right now. So yeah, that's always fun.
That's really neat. Yeah. That's I mean, I don't know. That's the kind of stuff that like would just scare the hell out of me, getting up on stage and acting. I mean, it's kind of weird, like a comic artist to be doing that kind of stuff, because a lot of times comic artists seem kind of shy and withdrawn, you know, and everything they're doing is like on the page, you know.
Right. Yeah. Well, that's the reason I did theater, was to break. I was so much more shy. You know, I was in a shell. Yeah. And getting into theater really helped break through that. I still got a ways to go, I think. But, you know, theater is kind of fun to kind of break through that. And you get builds confidence and stuff. So absolutely enjoy it.
That's really cool. Yeah. How'd you get into comics in like the first place? Like where did your interest come from that like sparked you to want to, you know, eventually make a comic that, you know, was on the web and stuff?
It goes kind of way back to my parents. My mom first, because she would used to buy us Archie comics and, you know, Little Devil and Casper and stuff like that. And I just pored over those, you know, Popeyes and all that kind of stuff. And I got into drawing because of my dad, not because he could draw, it's because he couldn't draw. Because one time I brought him a piece of paper and a pencil. I said, draw me a real person. I must have been like 5 or 6. And he goes, he drew me stick person. I'm like, no, draw me a real person. He says, no, you draw it. So ever since then, I've been drawing and stuff and going over those comics and that my parents would bring me and stuff and just kept drawing those characters and stuff. And I think kind of that affected my style, you know, especially those Archies. And because I know Movie Men, some people have been comparing the characters kind of like stylistically kind of a little too Archie style. So I was like, that must have carried over from those days. So I must be thinking that in the back of my head or something, because it feels like a, you know, kind of Archie gang thing that these people are and stuff like that. So, but then I really got into superheroes when my cousin brought me this huge grocery bag just filled to the brim with comic books, and that just like blew my mind. And just all these, you know, I had Silver Age comics and Bronze Age comics, you know, it just poured over them, just love those, and I kept drawing all those. And so yeah, that was my big influence, a big bag of comics. So
and you know, it's funny, like you kind of mentioned Archie. I do kind of see that in your work, you know. You've got like a very cartoony style. I mean, it's very comic booky, and it just fits like the look of like what you guys are going for, I think. So
yeah, I hope so. Yeah, I'm glad he liked it to use for that. You know, so I enjoyed drawing the monsters and stuff, you know, the creatures and stuff, because I think I was drawing a lot more creatures at one point before I was drawing people. So, yeah, so monsters are just kind of my favorite thing.
That's cool. Yeah. That's neat. Did you go to art school or anything? Like, how did you get eventually, you know, to where you are now?
I went to college, but I wanted to get into animation, and they kind of lied to me. I won't mention the school. Said, oh, yeah, we do animation. We took one class, and we drew one cell of animation. And they're like, there, that's it. I'm like, thanks a lot, you know? Yeah. I mean, I really actually wanted to go out to the school, the one out east, New Jersey. The
Cooper School?
Thank you. Yeah. My mom wouldn't let me because it was just too far away, you know? And, but I feel like my real art training is when I went to Valley Fair, to do caricatures. Okay. And I worked with Tom Richmond. He contracted me. He does, Mad Comic. He's the artist on Mad right now. And, really a lot of great, great artists. We just like bounced off each other. We pushed each other. And that was like my most formative, experience as an artist, I felt like, because we just kept pushing there, you know, met other artists who went on to do great things, and you know, into comic art and stuff, and we just kept pushing each other. That was like my most favorite experience of my life. So
yeah. And you guys were all doing like caricatures in
yes.
Yeah. Yeah. That's pretty extreme. I can see how, you know, cause there's a lot of stress and that kind of type thing. And I could see how that would grow in leaps and bounds very quickly. You know?
Yeah.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah. So. Yeah. I think you can see it. Some of my panels, some of the background characters have more caricature-y faces rather than the main characters. So
right.
I kind of put that in there.
Yeah.
I enjoy the humor in it. Yeah. And he's got these great, Jeremy's wrote these great little characters, you know, they've got their great succinct little personalities and, you know, try to convey that in those images. And I hope I did the job.
Right. How long is the book? I mean, is it like going to be an ongoing series or is it just kind of a short book or what?
I'm not sure of Jeremy's intent. I would think so, because there's plenty to mine there for movies and stuff, movie tropes and everything. So there's plenty to go off there. And I think it could go ongoing, you know. If not, I'd certainly had fun working on it. And
So at this point, it's kind of stopping, but it's probably maybe going to go on depending on how successful or something.
Correct, yeah.
Thanks for visiting with me for a while. And I hope you guys' Indiegogo is a big success. And I like the art. The book looks great. So you're doing a good job.
Well, thank you. Coming from you, that means a lot. I appreciate it.
All right.
So before we dive into it, I just want to show people something.
Oh, cool. Yeah, wait, let me click on you so it'll stay there for a second.
Okay.
There it is.
Yeah.
That's awesome, man. It's very cool to see it framed up and everything. Well, welcome to this show, Jeremy. I appreciate you coming on.
I appreciate the invite.
Yeah, no problem. I've known you a little bit, you know, just from the comments and stuff on YouTube and I guess maybe talking back and forth a little bit on Twitter and stuff. So kind of know each other, but not that much.
No.
But I just thought it'd be like a good opportunity to kind of get to know each other a little bit. And hopefully I can help you kind of promote your book. I see you guys are about, I think when I went over there, it's about 45 or something percent funded. So you guys are almost there.
We have it for a long campaign. So it's a 2-month campaign. The monetary goal is 2,000. I set that fairly low, just because I want to meet the monetary goal and then move on to just try to get as many readers as we can.
Yeah, I think that's a good way to do it.
Yeah. And, you know, we're at like 900 and something of 2,000 after, you know, a week and a half. So we're not doing too bad.
Yeah, that's great. How come you picked Indiegogo? I've been talking to a lot of different people, and it's funny, like some people are going back to Kickstarter now, and I love Indiegogo myself, but... why'd you end up going with them?
There are quite a few Facebook groups that I do something called the Bust an Update for, where I actually look at Indiegogo pretty closely. And I've just I'm much more familiar with Indiegogo, and I've also bought more stuff from Indiegogo. And I find it, the interface is just a lot easier to deal with. You know, on Kickstarter, you buy something and then, you know, once it gets funded, you have to send your address, which I find very annoying. I like it that it's a one-stop shop with Indiegogo. I also, when it comes to, I haven't marched through actually doing this, but I know people that have worked with Kickstarter, they have to approve this stuff. Whereas with Indiegogo, you just go live, you're there, you know?
Yeah.
You know, now you can screw it up if you don't know what you're doing, but I don't think I did. So
yeah, I like that too. You know, I like just the fact that you get the thing going. You know, didn't have to go through the whole whatever that process is. You know, qualification process or whatever they call that. You know, because I did one Kickstarter before this for an art book, and I don't know. Just out of the two experiences, I was just like, I don't want to go back to Kickstarter after Indiegogo. So.
I mean, one thing that Kickstarter has going for it that Indiegogo is, you know, I think it'll get there eventually, but there's a lot more foot traffic on Kickstarter than Indiegogo. Just the people will just come browse versus you have to bring people to Indiegogo to, you know, buy your stuff. And, you know, so it's a little different model.
Yeah. And the in demand thing, after you fund is really awesome, you know, because like the Berserkonauts continued to kind of sell. And that's just that, you know, I don't think they got something like that on Kickstarter. So that's really cool.
You're damn close to 8,000, aren't you?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm like right on the cusp. So that's really cool.
Yeah. What was your monetary goal? Was it 3,500 or am I wrong about that?
Yeah. Yeah. It was like 3,500. And I think when it funded it funded for just over 5,000.
Yeah.
So it's crept up, you know, since then to 8,000, which is awesome. Didn't even expect that at all. I didn't think really anybody would come along after the fact. So.
Yeah. No, you can. Yeah. I like the InDemand thing.
Yeah. Well, I should ask you about your comic. I want to ask you one question before I kind of forget, because this is something that's been kind of in my mind lately.
Okay.
And when I was talking to Doug, he mentioned he does web comics and has had like a web comic going for like, you know, 20 years or something, which is really cool. What's your opinion of like the model, I think, for, you know, funding comics like up till now, I would say is, you know, doing the web comic, building that audience, and then, you know, funding something with that audience, you know. But it's kind of like changed lately, where it's like a lot of people are just bringing a comic straight to, you know, a crowdfunding platform, and then, you know, here it is, and then, you know, funding it that way. And you guys, I don't think you've got Monster Men up at, or not, I don't know why you call them Monster Men.
Movie Men. We deal with monsters, so I get it.
Right. Yeah. That's probably why it's in my mind. But, you know, I mean, I don't think it's up as a webcomic anywhere, right? I mean,
no, it's not.
Right.
You know, I know that, yeah, with Berserkonaut, you had, if not all of them, at least almost all the pages visible beforehand.
Right? I did. Yeah, I was putting it up, and I've kind of struggled with it, just kind of like thinking, like, should I go back and start putting it back on Webtoons, or should I not? Or, you know, so I guess that's kind of why it's on my mind.
Yeah, part of it is just that it's, a lot of it is different audiences, because people will want to consume it one way or another, right? They'll want a digital, or they'll want, you know, tactile. Most comics, I like the tactile comic, but we have a digital version available. Partly because, you know, look, if you want that, great, but it's also just that foreign shipping is so expensive that I'm telling foreign customers, look, if you want to pay for it, great, we'll let you pay for shipping, but if not, just get the PDF and make do with that. And, you know, I'm sorry that's suboptimal, but it's something.
Yeah, well, you just can't get around it. I mean, there's, you know, international shipping is just ridiculous. So.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
No, there's an artist named Abai Canales, and I've worked with him on a couple of different, he did one of the pinups for this, for instance. I was sending him the complete something from Alterna Comics, and it actually cost more to ship the damn comics than to order them.
Yeah, yeah, I can believe that. And of course, the Alterna Comics are cheap, but
yeah,
still.
No, I think the way around it. The order was like 55, and the shipping was 65.
Wow!
Oh my God, that was painful.
Yeah. All right. Well, anyway, let's get back to your comic. I mean, like, what's it about? I mean, what's the story and stuff?
Yeah, Movie Man. So I'll tell you where it started. Several years ago, Regal Cinema, they changed their uniforms, so they looked a little bit like kind of like dorky X-Men outfits. Mm-hmm. And you had this thing of me actually going up to several people there and saying, "Do you feel like a superhero in that costume?" None of them ever did.
I bet they love that.
Yeah. But so that got my, I thought, well, what, so, okay, so what would it take to have a super team that worked in a movie theater, right? And so that was spinning through my head. And I used to see a ridiculous number of movies in the theater. I would see over 50, you know, a year. I think I topped out at 75 one year. So one of the things that you see, like in 5 or 10 minutes into every movie, is some usher will come in with a little glow wand and make sure that the exit's, you know, secured, so people aren't sneaking in. And so I thought, what if he found a bomb, you know? And so that is an important part of this comic. So he finds a bomb and he yells bomb and then he gets trampled. And he wakes up just in time for it to explode, but then he's still standing and the theater is still there. And then he finds out that the dinosaur is missing from the screen.
Yeah.
So that's sort of the setup. And what this bomb is we call it a reality bomb. And so it knocks all of the monsters off the screen, but it also gives the theater workers tools to try to defeat these monsters.
Oh, cool. That's a great premise. You know, especially when you think of like all kinds of like what, you know, anything could be on the screen, all sorts of movies and stuff. So.
Oh, yeah.
That's really neat.
And you have these kids who are discovering that they, you know, A, the monsters are missing, B, they're supposed to do something about it, and C, how do you do that?
Yeah. And the book looks great. I think like Doug's art really kind of fits it. It looks kind of like there's a little bit of humor in the book and stuff, and
yeah,
it's that a lot.
Yeah, no, there's definitely humor. It's somebody described it to me, and I think this is accurate as it's kind of Archie meets Ghostbusters with a little bit of Last Action Hero thrown in.
Oh yeah.
And the Archie thing, you know, it wasn't my intent, but Doug has been very influenced by Archie comics, and you know, it's a bunch of kids having wacky hijinks. So yeah, okay, that works. Archie.
Yeah. Yeah. And that's what he was telling me too. And I see a little bit of that in there, you know, it's not like super prevalent, but I do see that cartooniness.
I've loved working with Doug on this. He, all the designs, if you go to the web Indiegogo, his initial designs I just used for all the perks, of all the different characters, because he got it in one, basically.
Yeah.
You know, we didn't have to do it any tweaking. He just, what I said is, I described some of the characters, and then I said, I want the costumes to be sort of a combination of regal outfits and Challengers of the Unknown uniforms. He did, a perfect mashup of that.
Yeah. I asked him how you guys like met and all that kind of stuff. I mean, was he kind of like your first choice on as an artist? And did you just go straight for him, or did you try out different people? Or
so we met by we're members of several different Facebook groups that overlap. And I saw some of his art and just approached him and said, you know, would you be interested in doing something? I know you have this webcomic thing, so I don't know how busy you are. And he said, you know, I can. Pay you to do some designs, and if that works, then you know we could do a comic book. And he said, "Yeah, sure, I'm available to do that." So that's what we did. I have approached several different artists about doing different comics, and I have a bunch of balls in the air. This was the first one to kind of land.
Oh, okay, cool. So you're gonna go on with this and do some different books too, then, huh?
Yeah.
Have you ever done comics before? Is this kind of like your first sort of foray into comics?
Yeah, this is my opening. There was another Kickstarter where they had a thing where you could, there was a tier that said, "I'll draw your comic." It was called Knight Errant. And so I emailed the guy and said, "What do you mean draw my comic?" And he said, "Well, I'll draw a 4-page story for you, include it in my comic."
Mm.
And I said, "Okay, but I don't have any like knights and maidens stories." And he said, "Well, that's okay. You know, I'm open to pretty much anything as long as it's not completely absurd."
Yeah.
And so I came up with a character named Huckleberry Black. He's a detective in Vegas. And it's a 4-page story about him finding a ghost and finding a way to make the ghost go away.
That's cool. Yeah.
So that may see print before this does, but as far as first full comic, yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
So but David, I was good. Okay.
Well, I was just going to say, even though it's like your first in the comics, you've been a writer before this, right? I
mean, oh yeah.
Yeah. That's wrote a lot of stuff.
When I was in college, writing was the way I paid the bills.
Yeah.
You know, I decided I liked the night job better basically when I graduated. And so I've been a journalist and various other things for the past 20 years. So, I've written some books. I wrote a book about a history of the vice presidents called The Warm Bucket Brigade. you know, I wrote some more obscure things. I was, there's a former governor of Maryland named Marvin Mandel, and I was the recognized ghostwriter on his memoirs called I'll Never Forget It. And I've written, I don't know, thousands of articles for hundreds of publications. Just Google me.
Yeah, that's awesome.
But I tried to write fiction, but one of the problems I would always run into is voice, in the sense that they all sounded like me. And in the last couple of years, I've seen people who are comic fans, and I'm a lifelong comic fan. I was actually a comic fan before I read a comic book.
Yeah.
Because of the movie Condor Man.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, you know, he's the comic book artist who the CIA funds to try to get this Russian agent, you know, this defection going. And, you know, they pay for him to have all the cool stuff he does in his comic books. He tries it out in real life. And so
a TV? It was like a TV movie, wasn't it?
It was it was in the theater, but it was 1978.
Okay. That yeah. Well. I remember seeing it as a kid, but it's just like, I haven't thought about that thing in forever.
So. Yeah. You'll probably remember this. Remember video stores, how they initially VCRs were quite expensive. And so a lot of times you couldn't afford a VCR. So they would rent you a VCR, right?
Yeah. We'd go down and we'd rent the VCR on a couple movies.
Yeah, exactly.
and so kind of like a suitcase kind of thing.
Yeah.
Suitcase it, you know, plug it into your TV.
I went to a video store with my parents when I was, maybe I was three, I don't know. You know, that was the thing. We were going to rent a VCR and some movies, and there was the Disney shelf, and Condor Man is a Disney movie. And I said, oh, let's try that one. And oh my God, they regretted that, because then every time we would get a VCR, I'd have to get Condor Man.
Oh, that's funny. Yeah, that's how it is with, like, because, you know, there's, like, so many, like, when I used to have, like, a lot of VHS tapes, you know, you just, you know, have your certain movies, and there's just, like, those bad ones that you just watch a million times, you know?
Yeah.
I don't know. So I could totally see that, you know?
Yeah, and I didn't realize until I was much older just how much that determined the course of my life, because it determined that I was going to be a comic book fan. It also colored my politics, because I really hated the Russians, because they wanted to stop this nice lady from coming to the U.S. and watching a baseball game.
Yeah.
You know, I don't know. That is the movie for me.
That's wild. Yeah, I got to go back and like watch that again now that we've like talked about it, and see what I remember and what I didn't. It's got to be on YouTube somewhere or someplace.
Yeah, I mean, you can find it. You can get it on DVD, but it's expensive. It's like $40.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
It's so niche, it's like hard to find, probably. So
yeah.
That's cool.
So, yeah, so that was the thing that set me on the course for being a comic book fan. And so when I was in my teens, I was a heavy collector and also kind of a speculator. I was really good at buying stuff that was going to be popular. And so and then I would go to shows and you know, I was a little cocky. I just walk up to dealers. I'm like, all right, what are we going to do? And I would, you know, fan a bunch of comic books out at them. And my dad remembers this one time where, you know, I was one of the guys I normally deal with just horribly lowballed me. And I just put my stack back together and walked toward the door. And he like chased me to the door.
Right.
But then I, you know, I decided that, you know, I was going to put away childish things and you know, all right, comic books are for kids. And so I stopped doing that, and I went and lived and worked in Washington, D.C. for 7 years, you know, was a real adult. And I just said, this sucks.
Yeah.
Yeah. So then I moved back to my to Washington State and picked up comic books again and haven't really looked back.
What kind of stuff were you reading back then? Like, what was your favorite comics and stuff?
You know, I really liked Valiant Comics in the early 90s. Yeah. They were a lot of fun.
Good stuff. Jim Shooter.
Yeah. That's awesome. Yeah, they did a lot of good stuff. But, you know, I was never, you know, Marvel or DC guy, or I liked Valiant a little bit more than those. But, you know, I remember, like, the Spectre, that when John Ostrander wrote it, and I'm trying to remember who the great artist was on that. It was really good. Or like Spider-Man 2099 with Peter David and Rich Leonardi.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
Leonardi is on that. Just, you know, but the other thing is that I would page through the previews and then, what was the capital city? They had, it was a different name. You know, the indie section was the thing that I cared most about. And so I'd always go through and just try to find cool stuff and, you know, just see what was available. And yeah. I had a lot of fun with that. The '90s were, at least the early '90s, were great for comic books.
And they were great for indie books too, because there was kind of that rise of the indie comic after Image came along, you know, companies like Valiant and stuff like that, and Dark Horse. And there was a lot of good indie books for them. So,
yeah, I mean, they were what, close to 20% of the industry at one point. I mean, it was the thought was that, you know, the indies are going to be the future.
Yeah. Yeah, it's kind of weird how like Marvel and DC have kind of like clamored back, but there still is, you know, it never went back to like that two company scenario that it was before Image, you know. So
yeah, that's true.
There's a lot of other, you know, companies like Dynamite and stuff, but yeah, I don't know. Those to me like aren't even like indies, you know. They're almost like just, I mean, they all do like licensed stuff and it's not that much unusual stuff. I like the unusual stuff, I guess.
Oh so. Yeah, I mean Berserkonaut.
Yeah, obviously. Let's talk about your perks and stuff on the Indiegogo. Okay. What are you pricing the book at, and also how long is the book?
The book is 20 pages, and there could be an additional 4 pages if there's a one of the largest perk is that someone can pay to be featured in a story.
Oh, cool. Well, let's talk about that for a second.
Okay.
So is it going to be just like a short story in the comic, kind of like the one you were talking about before? So like a 4-page story or something?
Yeah, it'd be a 4-page story after the comic that would involve one or more of the movie men and whoever wants to do this. And I'll, you know, it'll be my story, but I'll work with whoever to try to incorporate them in a kind of a funny little story.
Yeah, that's neat. That's really cool.
There's the perk just above that, is you can be a cop in the story. And so there's a few cops toward the end and one person has already done that. And so there's one more slot for a boy or a girl in blue. If you want to buy in for that, people. but I mean, look, we're starting at $4. If you want a PDF, it'll cost you $4. The comic itself will cost you $5 plus $5 shipping. So it'll get to you for $10 domestically. Then, you know, we add stuff on top of that. If you want to get the comic plus 2 pinups by Canales and Sean Hall, that'll cost you $24 plus, I don't know, $6 shipping and handling, I think. So $30. And then if you want to get the comic and a picture of or a drawing of one of the movie men by Doug, I think that's $40. Now I actually have to go back and look at my own.
That's very original. I mean, reasonable for like an original drawing and stuff in there. That's awesome, man.
Yeah. And then we've got $55 will get you the comic book, the 2 pinups and a shirt, and $75 will get you all of the, you know, below the drawing, the pinups, the shirt and the comic. We also, if you want to send some to the troops, for $20 you can send 4 of them to the troops. We're paying shipping.
That's cool. How'd you come up with that idea? I haven't heard that one before.
Oh, the troop thing?
Yeah.
There's a few of the campaigns that do this, and the Lone Wolf campaign, they were having a hard time getting above $4,000, which they absolutely needed to do to get to hire a colorist. And so I partnered with 3 or 4 other people and just pushed them above that with the troop thing.
That's really cool. Yeah. What about like your printing and stuff? I mean, are you guys got the book done yet or not?
The book is done. We haven't printed it, obviously, because we're gonna adjust a few faces for the cops, and we may tack on 4 pages at the end. I've partnered with a publisher called Wicked out of California. They did the fulfillment on the Jack Irons campaign.
Oh, okay.
And they will. I'll work with them. They'll print it and ship it to people. And they've done, you know, shipping and printing and fulfillment before and quite effectively.
Yeah, that's cool. So since you're partnering with somebody, are they going to like distribute to and go into comic shops or?
Yeah. After this is done, then they will be the sort of long tail of this. They don't have diamond distribution, which is a problem, but right now, people getting diamond distribution is just so difficult. I know you've been, how is that coming for you?
Well, I have been approved, but I'm waiting until I wanted to wait till the third issue before I actually start going through them, because I'm a little scared that I'm going to, you know, I don't want to miss deadlines, but I'm basically going to do it when I hit the second book done, then I'm going to start, and then I'm going to put it out quarterly through Diamond. But I've been accepted, but they wanted, like, you know, the commitment, like a quarterly commitment. And I just said, like, well, let me do one more and then we'll do it. So it hasn't, you know, I don't have any numbers as far as like the orders yet, but, it will eventually get into comic shops. So, but it was kind of jumping through some hoops for sure. And also if I think I have to sell, it's a money number. It's not like a, you know, number of issues, but I think it's like $600 or something of product. You know, if you don't get that amount of orders, which is pretty low, then, you know, Diamond won't actually take the book. They just like cancel the whole thing. So,
yeah. Yeah. I'll be sure to order it and try to get some people at my shop to do that.
That's cool. But you know, I mean, you gotta start somewhere, right? So, you know, I think actually going through another, you know, like you said, like a partner that's actually going to ship your book and stuff, that's kind of awesome. You know, you won't have to like package up all that stuff yourself and send it out.
Yeah. Like, the more I looked at what people have to do, I just said, I don't want to do that. So, you know, they offered a pretty good deal and the really good deal for fulfillment, and then a good deal after that for profit split and all that. And they aggressively sell the stuff at shows. And I mean, basically their model right now is they sell through some comic shops and a lot of shows, and they'll give you product to sell at shows. And so, okay, that's fine. I can do that.
Yeah, that's cool. Are you planning on going to any comic cons? Like, once this thing gets going?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. I mean, I'll go to any of the local ones that I can. So I'm up in Linden, Washington, which is just right on the Canadian border. Our closest, there's a Bellingham Comic Con that is the thing here, but, I hope next year to go to, Emerald City Comic Con, and, you know, there's the one in Portland, and there's other smaller ones around the area that I'd like to go to. And perhaps even up over the border in Canada. Yeah, I really want to punch the local angle just because, you know, it's Bellingham's only super team. So I want to see if I can sell this very aggressively in Bellingham and Whatcom County.
So it's actually based on like a specific city, like Bellingham. Is that where you live or close to or something?
Yeah, I live in Whatcom County. Bellingham is the biggest city in the county.
Oh, that's neat.
Yeah, and the theater is made up. It's fictionalized, but it's based on a Regal theater there. But like when they go downtown, that's somewhat accurate to downtown. When they go to the mall, people who've been to the mall can recognize it, that kind of thing.
That's really cool. I mean, that's neat. I mean, it kind of reminds me of, like, you know, Stephen King, you know, like I live in Boulder, Colorado. So like, you know, in the Stand, they end up in Boulder and stuff. And it was neat to kind of like, you know, places that he was talking about and stuff. And, that's a cool idea. I didn't realize that. So.
And then I also want to, like, I want to try crazy things. Like, I want to go to some local businesses and say, look, we could put a different cover on this, you know, where they're like, oh, we need to go fight the monsters, but first we have to finish drinking our Woods coffee, or, you know, something like that.
Yeah, totally. I could see some, like, advertisement stuff in the back for that. That'd be neat.
Yeah, or I just got an email back from we have a local collegiate summer Woodbat summer league called the Bellingham Bells that I'm a season ticket holder at, and once a summer they do a movie on the green kind of a thing. Mm-hmm. And I said to the manager, general manager, I said, well, what if we did a comic where it's that movie but monsters come out of the screen? And she goes, okay, let's explore that.
That's pretty neat. Yeah. I mean, it's like, I like the, like, you know, you're thinking like the local type thing, because it's like, you know, I mean, it's cool to try to get through Diamond and go into the shops, but, you know, there's so many shops that just don't care about indies and stuff.
Yeah.
And it's just, that's what I kind of like about the sort of like indie comics movement, is it's like this sort of like different way of like making money and different way of selling comics and, you know, just, I mean, it's like, it reminds me of like when I was younger, you know, and you draw a comic and you just like go to copy it up at Kinko's and staple it together, and you're just like handing it out and sticking it in, you know, different coffee shops and stuff, and you just don't know who gets it, but you actually get it out there, you know. It's just kind of neat, you know.
Yeah. So. No, I definitely, I mean, you know, and the buy local thing's really big right now. Well, okay, here you go, guys, go. Right. Local.
Homegrown comics, man.
Yeah.
Totally.
You know, we'll see what happens, but I think we'll get this funded, and I would like it to get much more than funded. I want to get this into so many people's hands, and I want to sell as many as fast as I can, obviously, but I also want to play like the long game in the sense that, you know, I want to be around this comic, be around for several years at the very least, you know, selling to lots of copies to lots of different people.
Yeah. So are you planning on, is this like an ongoing series, or is it like each one's going to be kind of separate? Are you going to go on with it after this one?
We're not going to do a numbered series, but okay. Each story will be self-contained, but you know, there will be continuity between them, that kind of thing.
Right.
I think the second one would be like a short graphic novel. That's my thought right now. It'd be the Movie Men meet Dr. Frankenstein and his monster.
Oh, cool. Yeah.
And I sent a treatment of the beginning of that to Doug that he'll draw at some point, because I just came up with this. How often does just inspiration just strike you and you go, I got to write this down?
Yeah, absolutely. I have that happen. I mean, the Berserkonaut was that, you know. Shouldn't be doing comics, really. That's not that we really make money. But yeah, it's like when that stuff hits, it's like that's what makes it fun, you know, and that's what like makes it, like, you want to be an artist, you know what I mean? It's not for like the 900th commission I've drawn of like Indiana Jones. It's like when that stuff hits and you're just like, yes. And then you just work and work and work, you know?
Yeah, no, it really is a labor of love. It's you're exploring things and it's wonderful.
Yeah. And it's kind of cool, like, how you have the angle of like the movie theater in the story. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, you kind of can bring in, like you said, things you love. Like, you know, like I'm a big fan of like the old monster movies and stuff like that. And it's just like, you know, you just have like access to all that stuff, you know, since you're basing it on like, you know, stuff coming out of a screen and stuff like that. So.
Yeah. I think like a third story would probably be an alien invasion, because why not?
Totally. Are like the kids that work in the theater sort of like, like, are they like a team that kind of like hold together as like a superhero team in the book, or is it?
Yeah, I mean, they're a bunch of friends and colleagues, and they, through their adventures, they get closer, and I mean, they're kind of like the Ghostbusters, except they're kids.
Yeah.
You know, cause, I mean, the ghosts they're busting are monsters from movies, but.
Right, right.
You know, they don't have, you know, the backpacks, but they have other things.
Right. So they're trying to get the monsters kind of back. I mean, I don't want to wreck anything, but I imagine they're trying to get them back in the movie.
Yeah. What they do is they have to defeat the monsters and then they automatically go back in the movie.
Oh, I see. You mentioned you were thinking about at least doing other comics and stuff. I mean, is that kind of like the long game eventually, just kind of have like several comics coming out?
Yeah, I mean, I want to get, I'm not going to make the goal, but my idea was to have 5 comics out this year.
Oh, wow. Okay.
I don't think, you know, I think I'll get, you know, if we're counting Huckleberry Black, I might get to 4. I'll get 3. But I mean, I have like other comics that are close to done. I got one that's completely penciled and inked, and it's almost done being lettered, and then I have to get it colored. The great thing about Doug, and I didn't expect this, is, you know, it came back complete, you know. He does everything other than the writing.
Really? Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. So I sent it to him and thought, well, I'll get, you know, inks back, and instead it comes back colored and lettered. You're amazing.
Yeah, that's awesome. I mean, yeah, it just takes it off your plate. You don't have to worry about it now. Which that makes sense. That makes sense to go for like a webcomics guy, because he does that all the time anyway. So.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, I didn't even. I mean, I should have thought in those terms, but that's not what I was thinking.
Yeah, well, the book looks great. I mean, I hope you guys do well. I hope my little piddly show here gets you at least some backers, you know. How much longer, actually? Let me ask you, how much longer do you got to go? Do you run a short campaign or?
No, long campaign. I think we've got, more than a month and a half left.
Oh, okay, yeah. Yeah. You guys really, okay. Yeah. I think mine was like 20 days and I was like, I had it at the end of those 20 days. Yeah. I get so stressed out when they're going, but that's probably the better way to do it. I think if, you know, you're hanging around longer, that gives them more of a chance to get kind of discovered and stuff.
Yeah. I mean, the thing I wanted to do was to give people, you know, I know that there are people who are on budgets and I wanted to give them a lot of chances to factor this into their paydays, you know, and for $4 or $10, you people can get in on this. Or if you know you want to do something cooler, we've got those things too.
Yeah, it's a great jumping on price. You know what I mean? $4. It's just like a normal Marvel comic. You know, $3.99 or something. So, or actually, I guess the physical copy is $5. But still, like for an indie comic, $5 is like, you know, that's totally doable. So I hope people jump on and you know, go for it. So.
So do I.
All right. Well, thanks a lot for coming on the show. I really appreciate it. It was great talking to you.
Thanks for having me, man.
All right. That's it. See you guys later. All right. There it is. Doug Curtis, Jeremy Lott, and Movie Man. Go check it out on Indiegogo. The Berserkonaut is actually still on Indiegogo if you want to pick up my comic. It's in demand, so it'll be there for a while yet. And sign up for the mailing list. Get notifications every time a new video comes out because YouTube doesn't send them anymore. So that's an easy way to do it. Sign up. I don't spam you. I just say, hey, there's a new video up. See you guys next time.